Welcome to the Sport of Politics with Joel Robidoux on 103.7 The Game. Online at 103.7thegame.com. We discuss the local issues affecting you and the Acadiana area with Lafayette City Parish Mayor President Joel Robidoux. From time to time, we'll have special guests and always make time to take your calls. Now, time for the Sport of Politics with Joel Robidoux. Here's your host, Dave Schultz.
Good morning, Acadiana. Dave Schultz along with Mayor President Joel Robidoux on the Sport of Politics on 103.7 The Game, replayed Friday mornings at 7 on KDCG TV. Lots to talk about today. Lots going on in the world of politics, local, state, and national. Good morning, Joel. How are you?
Morning. How you doing?
I'm doing well. Doing very well. We'll see how the second of 2 5-hour energy drinks keep me going here on a Thursday morning. Sport of Politics.
Well, hopefully they won't affect you in a negative way. We'll see.
Stay nice.
Yeah, yeah.
Be nice.
I changed what I was going to say mid-sentence or mid-thought.
That's why you're a politician. Good job. Job well done. Okay. If you want to give us a call, 706-0111, 706-0111. Of course, Sport of Politics is powered by Charlie G's. All right, so where are we with the state? What are we in? A second week of regular session? Is there any update? Have we? All they can do is cut instead of raise.
You don't
raise
want to ask
right
me
now.
who I think is going to win the basketball game tonight?
We'll get to that. Oh, yeah.
All right. I was just jumping right into the state. I've got to tell you. Since the session is a regular session, then pretty much all they can do is cut.
Right.
And so they're going to have to figure out where those cuts are going to fall. I'm sure they'll try to prioritize them in some way. And so that when they go back into the special session, they'll identify if they're willing to raise any more revenue. And that revenue would then be used to offset the cuts that they had just passed. So whether that would be, pro rata, all the cuts would be reduced by 10% or 20%, or whether it would be specific saying, okay, well, this cut to higher ed is going to go away entirely, and then this cut's going to go away entirely. I guess it remains to be seen how they want to structure it, and remains to be seen what revenue, if any, they're going to be able to get passed.
Okay, so are we at the point yet where they are consolidating universities? Has anyone proposed that? Yet, because that's one that seems like everybody thinks that is going to happen. Your friend Senator Vitter mentioned it last week as we wrapped up Sports Chat on Friday from the Chittimacha, Louisiana Open.
I like how you refer to everybody as my friend, and like you don't have any friends. Is he not your friend?
I would hope that he was my friend. Oh, okay. He's been on my show a couple of times.
It
was a short interview, unfortunately, and I actually felt bad about cutting him off, but I asked a question, and with only a few seconds left to go, so that was my fault. So
gotcha.
I apologize. It should not cut off a sitting U.S. Senator retiring or not, and whatever you think. But go ahead.
Yeah, I think that I haven't seen any legislation that's been moving to do the consolidation, and I'm not sure exactly what the process would be. I mean, I would think the Board of Regents would have to make some recommendation on the colleges or the universities that they – that they think should be closed, and then make the case for that. And then the legislation may, and again, I'm not really sure, the legislation may just be to where it gave the authority to the Board of Regents to make whatever changes were needed as they saw fit.
And I wouldn't be able to think, and again, this is, because the budget is a immediate situation.
Yes.
They're not going to close the school now. Can they close the school now for the end of the year type of deal, end of the school year per se, and then thanks for coming, go somewhere else for the fall of 2016? Because that's pretty abrupt.
Yeah, well, the budget that they're discussing starts July 1 of 2016 and goes till 17. So, yeah, they may say that I'm not sure how much immediate income or, monies would be available by shutting down a school, but – yeah, I would assume if they go that direction, then it would be, hey, yeah, by the way, in the fall, kids, you need to go somewhere other than where you were planning on going.
Wow. I mean, so, I don't even know how that process would begin. Do you need to apply? Yeah. You know, is there an does there need to be an application process? Is there a waiver process? How do I get into this school?
Yeah, no. It's there's a whole lot. Yeah.
Yeah.
Which is why a lot of folks would say, yeah, that's not going to happen.
It may happen, but, yeah.
But that
it would take a year for it to happen, I would think. If it's going to happen, they would set the process in motion and give everybody, all right, by the fall of 2017.
Mm-hmm. But I guess
that would be an issue.
Right. But then the argument would be if we're trying to solve a $750 million budget shortfall for the 16-17 year,
right.
Then shutting down the university is doing nothing to solve that. So why don't we focus our attention on the problem at hand rather than,
right.
than you know, something that may be longer term in need. So, yeah, they...
I'm glad I'm not making that decision. I got a feeling you are, too.
Yo, I'm thrilled to be home.
Oh, goodness gracious. All right, well, let's talk about what's going on here. Let's see. They announced a series of public meetings to collect input regarding conditional use permits for new bars downtown.
Downtown, right.
All right.
Mm-hmm.
Let's discuss that.
Yeah, I forget how many years ago it was, but Lafayette had put a moratorium on bars and said, okay, no more bars downtown.
Sure.
And, well, you know, the thought was is we wanted to I'm assuming the thought was I wasn't involved in the in that process back then. But I think the thought was, hey, let's slow this down. We don't want downtown to become a Bourbon Street. And so if we, you know, just freeze everything where it is, then it'll allow us to, you know, try to attract some restaurants and some other types of businesses downtown, and it'll all be good. But ultimately that didn't happen. It changed the dynamic for the property owners, because the bars, by being limited, if a bar ended up having to close or fail, then the way the moratorium worked is that license would disappear if it was inactive for a year. So then you had folks rushing to get a bar in place so that they wouldn't lose that license with the moratorium. And so you didn't have the most, I think, the most deliberative, thoughtful process of establishing new bars. You just had folks opening them up just to keep the license. And then that didn't serve downtown well, because
no pun intended.
That's right. Yeah, that's right. Good. And then we had the Artmosphere situation crop up, where it was as much of a place to hang out and listen to music as it was a bar.
Right.
But by the numbers, food versus alcohol sales, it was defined as a bar.
Sure.
And so that kind of brought the moratorium issue to the front page, to where you say, okay, is this really working? Is this really what we want in every instance without any kind of flexibility? And so that's where this conditional use permit idea came about. And it wasn't for Artmosphere, but it was for opening the discussion to say, well, you know, there may be instances where we should consider another bar in the downtown area and allow it to happen if, you know, certain requirements are there. And so that's what these meetings are for, is for the public to come and for everybody to start to listen and engage in that discussion, and then ultimately the council will decide whether they think that's a good idea or not.
All right, we got a couple of different meetings here on the 29th of March, 7 a.m. They can all tune into Sports Chat.
Yeah.
On their way there. And Tuesday, March 29th at 6 p.m., Rosa Parks Transportation Center, multipurpose room. And then Friday, April 1st, April Fool's Day. I'm sure you have a line for that for me.
Uh-huh.
9 a.m., Rosa Parks Transportation Center, and at noon in the main library, second floor conference room. My first question, what you were mentioning, Artmosphere is considered downtown?
Yeah, I'd have to look at the map again.
Yeah,
but downtown, yeah, it's right there. You know, Johnson Street's one of the borders.
Right, right.
And so, you know, it's definitely downtown.
Okay, mm-hmm. Oh, definitely downtown. All mm-hmm. right.
Yeah.
It seemed to be on the other side of it, but all right, let's take a break. We got some guests. Stay tuned. Dr. Shania Nelson and Councilwoman Liz Hebert join us. You came packed with some guests today.
Yeah, people that know a lot more than I do.
Right, right, right. And probably me as well. Stop. Don't say nothing.
All right.
We'll be back with the Sport of Politics. Mayor Joel Robidoux. All powered by Charlie G's on Acadiana Sports Station 103.7 The Game.
Now, back to Sport of Politics on 103.7 The Game and 103.7thegame.com with Lafayette City Parish Mayor President Joel Robidoux. Here's your host, Dave Schultz.
All right, welcome back to the Sport of Politics, powered by Charlie G's on Acadiana Sports Station 103.7 The Game and 103.7thegame.com. We have a special guest, Dr. Shania Nelson, joining us, the Director of Community Development of Lafayette Consolidated Government. Dr. Nelson, thank you so much for joining us on the Sport of Politics. How are you?
I'm great. Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. All right. Let's before we get into specifics, what is your role with the government?
Well, I am in charge of the Community Development Department. The department consists of four divisions: Arts and Culture, Human Services, Housing and Federal Programs, and the Workforce Development Board. So I have a lot of diversity, a lot of variety under my department, but it's been a lot of fun learning all that I've had to learn.
Right. Okay, so it sounds like when you're Director of Community Development, it sounds like creating jobs.
Absolutely. Okay. That's a huge part of it. Also assisting people, those who are in need, of course, those from low to moderate income households.
Sure.
Is a target population of ours. I like to say that we offer a lot of high touch services to the public. We also have the senior centers is under our department, the Hyman Center, the Nature Station, the Natural Science Museum falls under community development, as well as what we'll talk about today with our grant funds that we offer to meet housing needs. So we'll get into some detail about that.
All right. Well, it would seem that you would be very busy with the downturn of the economy, trying to help people in need and try to help people find jobs.
Absolutely. With our Workforce Development Center, they're very busy. They're always receiving grant funds from the state, which is really excellent for the work that they do. However, the flip side of that is because they're so busy, they are busy because of the unemployment, unfortunately, here in the area. And so they do an excellent job of connecting people with jobs and assisting them and getting them on track. So very proud of the work that they do.
Do I see you about tickets to the Hyman Center shows?
Perhaps. Maybe
buddy,
after the buddy show.
Guy, buddy,
after the show.
Buddy Guy's coming. Buddy Guy. All right.
We'll talk.
Hall of Famer and Louisiana native, Buddy Guy. Just throwing it out there. All right. You're talking about the grant funds. Why don't we discuss that? What is that?
Sure. So the grant funds that we'll be discussing are the Community Development Block Grant Funds, which are also known as CDBG, as well as the Home Investment Partnership Funds, which are known as Home Funds. Those funds are distributed by the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development, otherwise known as HUD. These funds serve low to moderate income individuals through the provision of in-house counseling, housing rehab, demolition activities, first-time homebuyer assistance, and housing construction and rehab, which is carried out by local nonprofit agencies. The 2016 National Community Development Week will be celebrated March 28th through April 2nd, which is next week. And it just provides an opportunity for us to talk about CDBG and the home funds and the grantees who've been able to use those funds to provide services to people from low to moderate income households. Just a way to let the community know what it is that we do and all the wonderful clients that we've had the opportunity to work with and who've been able to benefit from those programs.
So you already have that money, or?
We have the money.
You have the money. So how do people go about getting some of their money for their assistance?
Well, the money, we've been receiving those funds from HUD mm-hmm. since the 1970s.
Mm-hmm.
And so really people just come to our office.
Oh.
Come to our office, visit us in City Hall. We're on the second floor, room 206, Community Development.
Right.
We have an excellent staff who's willing to assist our clients. Of course, we do have eligibility requirements that clients do have to meet in order to receive the assistance for housing rehab, demolition assistance, first-time home buyer assistance. But the first step would just be to come to us and visit with us, and we'll be happy to provide more information. But one thing that we are wanting to do is provide more outreach as well, in finding ways to find clients through local churches, perhaps, and other agencies who are already working with our target population. So we're working on some ways in order to do that, so we can actually be a little more proactive in getting out to the clients who can use our services.
We're talking with Dr. Shania Nelson, Director of Community Development for Lafayette. There is those set of apartments right on Congress.
Mm-hmm.
Is that private? They're low income housing, I guess, but they seem to be very nice.
Yes.
Condos. I tried to get in there, and shockingly, I make too much money.
Right.
Which is fine.
Sure.
But it's almost like it's I would say low income. It's almost as if they are like for UL graduates, like first time people who are getting their first,
yes,
you know, step into the real life,
right,
an opportunity to live in a nice place. Close, yes, to the train tracks, I will say that. But live in a nice place. Is that a public-private entity, or is that completely private, and that just the way they set that up?
That's private,
okay,
and that's just the way it's set up. Although I will say there are some opportunities perhaps in the future for public-private partnerships, and that's something that we're looking into and wanting to explore to be able to provide housing of that sort and other buildings, you know, to meet other needs as well. So.
All right. So this is just interesting because there was
a
maximum of how much you could make,
yes,
to get into those, to qualify. And it was not only low income, but almost young people.
Sure.
Housing is,
sure,
what is the way it was termed, because it's very, very, very nice, at least from the outside.
Yes.
At least from the outside. All right. So we're talking about, opening up new bars in downtown Lafayette. Do you have a position on that as Director of Community Development and my good time? In downtown Lafayette.
I can't, within
walking distance. Don't even have to Uber to downtown Lafayette.
Right. I can't quite say that I have a position on that right now. I'm fairly new. I've been on the job since the 4th of January.
Okay.
So still learning a lot, but I definitely see there's a lot of opportunity for development, economic development in a number of ways, not in a number of areas,
sure,
you know, not only in downtown, but in other parts of Lafayette. Definitely looking forward to learning more about those opportunities and how we can maximize our resources and leverage our resources, especially in our department, with our access to public funds. Again, with the public-private partnerships and those possible opportunities, would definitely like to explore that.
Now, it seemed what Joel was explaining is that where the buildings seem to have their own license, and because we've had, certainly have had some turnover, since, in the last year or two, about old places moving out and new places moving in, but it's the same place. So
yes,
that's not considered a new bar. Is that, I guess that's the situation?
Right.
That,
yes. Okay. Yes.
So the
as
property,
far as I understand it.
Okay. So it's not a person necessarily that holds it. It's almost the property that holds,
right,
the right to the serving the alcohol.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
All right. So that's interesting. All right. What else brings you by? You got anything else? We've got Festival International coming up.
Yes, we do have Festival International.
How involved are you with that?
We do provide assistance funding for that festival, and so we are involved. Again, we have an arts and culture division in our department, and so wanting to be even more involved in, the festivals and other cultural events that take place throughout the area. So really excited about that. Excited, looking forward to it. My husband is from Arkansas and has never attended Festival International before. So I'm looking forward to bringing him and letting him experience that.
All right.
He's looking forward to it too.
Joel says he's going to run the 5K with me. Are you going to run the 5K? Oh, no, now he's saying
Now.
He's backing out.
Well, I will say, I wouldn't be opposed to that.
I probably
need some training, though. But.
It's 5K. You can do it. So it's 3 miles. You can do that in your sleep. You can do that in your sleep.
I thank you for having faith in me.
You can do that in your sleep. We're going to do it after the wedding of the year, so we may be slightly impaired.
I mean,
we may be slightly impaired. Dr. Nelson, thank you so much for joining us on the Sport of Politics powered by Charlie G's. Please keep us updated. And if you have any new programs that people can get with you for assistance, please let us know.
Sure. Thank you so much for having me.
You bet.
Appreciate it.
All right. We'll be back with more Sport of Politics on Acadiana Sports Station, 103.7 The Game and 103.7thegame.com, powered by Charlie G's.
Back to Sport of Politics on 103.7 The Game and 103.7thegame.com.
All right, Dave Schultz, back with Mayor President of Lafayette City Parish, Joel Robidoux, on the Sport of Politics, powered by Charlie G's, Louisiana Done, the Lafayette Way on Acadiana Sports Station, 103.7 The Game, 103.7thegame.com, live and replayed on KDCG-TV Friday mornings at 7. All right, if you do want to give us a call, you're welcome to do so, 706-0111, 706-0111, and apparently we're having a parade on Saturday.
I think we're having a parade, a concert.
Nice.
We're having a whole lot of stuff to celebrate Mackenzie Bourque's impressive run on American Idol.
Very impressive.
And tonight, actually, for all the young listeners, please remember to
vote. Old listeners, too.
Well, the old listeners, I was going to say young listeners, please remember to vote. And the old listeners, please ask your kids to make sure and show you how to vote. Because if Mackenzie makes the final four, then what Idol does is they send all of the contestants home for their home visit, and they come and they film, and it'll be an opportunity for us to showcase Lafayette on national television. So we need everybody to help Mackenzie out. He's done a great job so far. I have all the confidence in the world that he'll do great tonight. But no matter how great he does, if we don't do our part and go vote for him, then, you know, it's our fault.
That's on a bunch of different levels, on a bunch of different things. We might not get to that today. I mean, his story is really tremendous. It really is a fascinating story. Besides being a very talented young man musically, right?
Yep.
He was a pretty good basketball player for our buddy Danny Broussard, my friend, Coach Broussard at STM.
After watching Danny dance on national television last week, you can have him as your friend.
Okay.
I'll take Dina, his wife, as my friend.
Right. I mean, he was, I don't think it's inappropriate to put deathly ill.
He had a
heart virus. He was out of school for a whole year.
Right.
He was in congestive heart failure.
Yep.
And if the virus didn't run its course and leave his heart, he wouldn't be here. So it is miraculous that he recovered, played another year of basketball, and has continued with his dream to become a musician. I mean, it really is. You know, if he doesn't win, it's got movie written all over it, right? I mean, this is a movie. His life is a movie so far, and if he does win, the movie writes itself.
Yeah, he's a really incredible young man, and you know, if you look for silver linings in situations, and he was. You know, he said it, that the virus and the you know, what he faced there really helped kind of, you know, provide him with that last little push to pursue his music career. And his focus changed, and he dedicated his life to it. And it's obvious. I mean, he's an extremely talented musician from a musically talented family. I mean, his brother was a talented musician also.
So you say Fox comes with him. Do we get J-Lo? Does J-Lo?
You know,
I'm not worried about the other two guys.
Do we want a little Jennifer Lopez? I don't know what we get out of it, but we get the national cameras.
Right.
And that's you know, as parish president and mayor, that's really all I care about. I would love the opportunity for Lafayette to be shown to the country and you know, highlighted in such a positive way.
Right. Okay.
And we can thank Mackenzie for that. You know?
And so if he wins, does he bring the crew back this weekend? Is that the deal, or is it going to be in the upcoming weeks?
No. This weekend, we're going to have something for Mackenzie regardless.
Regardless,
because he's done, you know, some great things for Lafayette.
Right.
But if he makes it through tonight,
right,
then when he comes in this weekend, the Idol crew is going to be following him and filming, you know, the parade, filming the concert, and that'll be used in next week's footage.
Well, apparently UL has high standards. He's only throwing out the first pitch on Saturday if he wins.
Yeah.
That's kind of lame.
I doubt that's true.
Okay,
you probably you know, you just need to settle down. I think your energy
That's what I was told, the reports. Well, he's throwing, if he wins, he's throwing out the first pitch. Well, I would let him throw out the first pitch regardless.
He probably is throwing out the first pitch. Your energy drinks are starting to kick in.
So yeah, I think they are.
I'm confident that UL would love to have McKenzie throw out the first pitch regardless.
All right. And where is this concert? Where is the parade starting? Do you know where the parade is starting? And where is the concert taking place? I presume it's Park International, but
Right. You're all right there. Uh-huh. And so I'm not sure where it's starting, but it's probably going to be like a downtown type parade. I assume. But if I'm wrong, then I will correct myself.
As a politician, are you in the parade? Are you taking advantage of the publicity and the notoriety?
Yeah. Now I know
coattails,
the energy drink is
the
kicking in.
The coattails of Mackenzie Borg.
Well, now I don't even want to say what my role is because, but I was asked if I would give him a key to the city.
Okay, and of course.
Most of that will probably happen at the concert, at the end of the parade, and before the start of the concert. Allow me to introduce him and say a few words and thank him for everything, that all the positive light that he's provided Lafayette with.
I have no shame. So if you want to get me in on the concert, and I'll be able to, I'll be happy to introduce you.
I'm trying to take the high road here.
You can take it under consideration.
I'll take it under consideration. There are a few folks that maybe rank a little higher than you as my spokesperson for parades and what I do and don't do. But thank you for the offer.
I could ride in the caboose. I got no shame of being in the parade at any point in time. Be first, last, in the middle. No shame.
Oh, that's good to know.
Duly noted.
There you go.
Duly noted. All right, so that is very exciting. Mackenzie Borg coming in. Again, American Idol tonight. You need to go out and vote. And obviously, it's over the phone.
Right? Well, there's all kind of ways.
All kinds of ways.
You can go to some Google apps. You can go to the American Idol website.
Right.
You can text over the phone. You can, I don't know. There's a bunch of ways.
Right. And, so tune into American Idol tonight.
Yep. Okay. I'll talk to your kids and ask them all the different ways to vote and just stay up
start
all night.
Dialing.
Start
dialing. Everyone's
start
got
dialing,
you.
Yeah.
So, you know, you got four phones in the house. Everyone's got a cell phone
voting.
These days.
And you're able to vote more than once, I think.
Right,
it's like
right.
Louisiana politics.
Yeah, you know, I was going to say Chicago, good point.
Either one.
All right.
Yeah, this is Louisiana. This is the sport of politics. So, yeah, so vote early and vote often.
All right. In this case, you can.
In this case, you're encouraged to.
Yes, you can. All right, let's take a time out. We're hoping to talk to Liz Hebert, councilwoman for Lafayette, and we believe District 8, but that may not be the case. She's happy to correct us when she gets
here. That's right.
All right. I'm still going to...
1 through 9. It's one of those.
Right. I'm still going to politic and lobby to get into the parade. I don't know if we can do that.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Let's see if I know the right person.
Yeah, I don't think you know him well enough. Check with Danny. Danny will probably be in the parade.
Danny probably will be in the parade.
Yeah. So, you know.
Whether he's welcomed or not, Danny's going to be in the parade.
I'm confident of that.
All right, we'll be back with more Sport of Politics, powered by Charlie G's Louisiana Dunn, the Lafayette Way on Acadiana Sports Station, 103.7 The Game.
Now, back to Sport of Politics on 103.7 The Game and 103.7thegame.com with Lafayette City Parish Mayor President Joel Robideau. Here's your host, Dave Schultz.
All right, welcome back to the Sport of Politics on Acadiana Sports Station 103.7 The Game. It'll be replayed on KDCG TV Friday at 7 a.m. We have our second guest of the show today, Councilwoman Liz Hebert from District 8.
Yes, sir.
Good morning, Councilwoman. How are you?
I'm doing wonderful.
Thank you
for having me.
No, thanks for coming in. All right, so this is one of Joel's big projects, the Kali Saloom Road Widening Project. Mm-hmm. Is it technically south of Ambassador Caffrey? I get my directions mixed up, but it is on the
correct.
It is on the other side. South side? Okay.
Yeah, it's on the opposite side. Coming, let me scoot a little closer. It is on, if you're thinking about where St. Thomas More is on the St. Thomas More
side
of Ambassador.
Correct. All right. So there's a meeting coming up for that?
Correct. Because there's so much interest in this project, it's been going on for a long time. People in the neighborhood have a lot of questions, and Joel was kind enough to make this one of his 6-month priorities was we wanted to get everyone on the same page. There's a lot of, I found while I was campaigning, there's a lot of information out there that wasn't in sync. So I wanted to make sure that everyone was on the same page right from the start. I'm new. Joel's new. We're going to have Joel's going to be there. His people in his office will be there. We're going to have the people with Fenstermaker who are the project managers. Does this keep running away from me? The mic keeps running away from me.
They're telling us to move it.
But no, so we're going to have everyone who's on the team there. We're going to have pictures of what it's going to look like. I'm hosting the meeting, so I'll, for the most part, get everyone caught up together on the same page. Joel's going to have a few words, and we're really going to let the project managers kind of take over, give everyone, most importantly, a timeline,
right?
Because we all want to know when this is going to be done.
Sure.
The project has been started. I think that's a misconception, is people think we haven't even started yet. But all the work that's been going on right now is all underground. We're not seeing the sewer and the water. That's going to be completed, I believe, in the end of this month, if I'm not mistaken. All that will be completed. Then the next, we're going to be working on utilities. And one thing I've found fascinating about this whole process is you think just, okay, LUS and Cox need to go in there. But it's the folks of Slimco, Cleco, you name it. There's so many things going underground right now. But, you know, us, the general public, you think until there's a cone on the road, until they're blocking off my road, it hasn't started. But it has indeed started.
All right. How long is the project, per se, the length of the road? Mm-hmm. Do we know how long?
How long the road? It will. So if you want to imagine from where Kali Saloom and Ambassador meet up,
right,
from there all the way to Ebroussard is the actual extension.
And how long is that?
How long is that? I think that's a 2.2 miles.
Oh, so over 2 miles.
Yes, sir.
All right. That's shorter than the 5K that Joel's going to run with me during Festival International, just to let him know. So that may seem long to him now, but it is not as long as the 5K. Are you running the 5K?
Oh, God, no. I can't run. Are you kidding me?
Come on.
I'll stick to the city council, you know, not running.
You know the other guy should get to run the 5K with me? Oh. Mark Hudspeth. He owes me a 5K run. I ran those stairs with him at that field. He can run the 5K with me.
I do not want to owe you a 5K. I'm going to stay on your good side.
Okay, so 2.2 miles. And how long do we think the project, you say that everyone wants to know, not necessarily when it's beginning, but when is it going to end?
When is it going to end, right? I think that's the final question. That's what I'm waiting to hear as well. Okay. So I'm really on the same page as, for the most part, as at the general public. And I live in that district, obviously, being the councilwoman. I don't live too far from there, but I have friends that live on that road. My vet's on that road. We all travel that road, right? So I want to, I'm with you, as I want this to be done, and this was a priority of mine as well.
Okay, so let's get some details. Is it going to widen the road on both sides, or are we making like a half a lane larger on one side, half a lane larger on the other, so then we sort of end up with a whole other lane? Or is it going to be one lane whole on one side and another whole lane, so we get two lanes on both sides?
That's what we're waiting to see from Fenstermaker and Associates. They're going to have the exact drawings. One thing that I could tell you is that at the end where East Bruce meets up with East Broussard is there's going to be a roundabout right there.
Mm-hmm.
And the current Kali Saloom Road that you see there is just going to be a right turn lane merging people onto Ebroussard. But the road is going to extend straight. We're going to add a new road straight onto Ebroussard.
Mm-hmm.
And there's going to be what's called a super roundabout.
A super roundabout.
Yes, yes. And what it is just basically an extra lane in the roundabout, just keeping people moving. A lot of people are nervous about roundabouts, right? Because we're Lafayette, we're slowly introducing roundabouts in the community.
Right.
People tell me, well, Liz, you know, it slows down traffic. It doesn't move traffic faster. But the studies have been done on this, and it absolutely does move traffic faster through an intersection. Because if you think about it, you get to a light and it's just you right there. You've got to sit at that red light.
Right.
Even though you want to go, right? Everyone wants to just go, but you can't, obviously. So with a roundabout, it just keeps the traffic moving.
Why do I think of European Vacation in the roundabout? I don't know. It seemed to...
Yep, that's right.
All right. I don't know if that's me, but showing my age a little bit. All right, so when... Okay, so we don't know when it's going to end.
Yeah.
When is the construction going to start on top of the ground? When are the cones going to be set? Do we have a timetable-ish?
Ish.
We're big on the ish around here.
Well, you have to be.
You
have to be, because there's no guarantees. Weather. If I can control the weather, I would be unopposed for the next 3 years.
Right.
If I control the weather, they'd kick Joel out and let me take Joel's position.
At the very least.
Joel would give me his position.
Right. Yes. Yes.
He's nodding his head here. But it's true. Is that especially, you know, with Louisiana, it's, you know, raining one minute, it's shining the next. But There's certain projects, utilities. You can't wait. You cannot work on utilities until the ground is dry. We do not want our people out there until the ground is dry. So weather plays a huge part on when our guys can get out there, how often they can get out there. But trust me, that's some of the things that I've been learning since I've been in office is that these government employees are not lazy. They work their tails off.
Right.
They do. They work so hard. They work practically around the clock. Whether you see it or not, they're out there working.
All right.
Yeah.
All right. So this meeting is when and where again?
So this meeting is taking place on March 29th, which is a Tuesday, starting at 6 p.m. It'll be taking place at the Southside Library, which is that newer library off of Johnson Street.
I would ask this. This seems to be a simple question, but I'll ask it anyway. Okay.
Here
no,
we go.
This seems to be a simple question.
Here we go.
Because it seems to be an issue, so there has to be another side of it. Is anybody against this?
I don't know how you could be against it, right?
Well, you would think not, but we have certain issues that people are against, but go ahead.
You know, hearing during the campaign was you knock on a door, right? And then you say, I'm running for city council. Tell me what you feel are the issues in Lafayette. Every single issue was traffic. Fix the traffic.
Right.
So this is another way that we're trying to fix the traffic. Of course, no one wants their life inconvenienced, right? Nobody wants to have a road narrowed down to one lane for a couple of weeks while they're working on the other side of the lane. Nobody wants to be inconvenienced. I sure don't. But this is progress. This is needing to happen, especially with our new development, Costco, right there.
Right there.
Especially with new neighborhoods being built out past E. Broussard. More people are going to be traveling that road. Growth is happening in Lafayette, especially in my district, District 8. It is happening whether we want it to or not. So we certainly have to come up with creative solutions to those traffic problems. We can't just not do anything.
You've made a run to Nordstrom Rack already, haven't you?
Oh, God, yeah. First day. Are you kidding me? Absolutely. Yeah, we have. In fact, I believe Wednesday is the day that they're going to be opening. Was that yesterday? My days are mixed up with me. But
go ahead.
Yeah, so all those great stores in the Costco development are opening. I've been to Chewy's for Mexican.
Right,
and let
me
tell you, it is fantastic. It is really great food.
Well, I think Dick's and Field & Stream are opening up next weekend.
Yeah, next weekend. Right? So, and those are huge stores. They had a slight opening the other day, and it's just amazing to go in there. I'm not a outdoorsy, sportsy person, but walking through there and seeing, you know, they have everything, even for someone like me who just wants to get yoga pants.
Right.
To look like I'm working out.
Right.
To give that impression. They have that there too. So, I mean, you know, and they have a really great, unique coffee shop concept that serves strictly only cold coffee.
Cold coffee.
Because we need that in South Louisiana, right?
Right. Well, in the summer, certainly.
Certainly. Right. So, you know, they've got all kinds of great stores coming in that development, which is good for us and is good for Lafayette. More sales tax for us, right?
Absolutely.
We
Absolutely.
Want it.
All right. Well, go into Dick's. Get your workout clothes.
I will.
You got a month to get into shape for the 5K.
We'll see about
Carrera
that.
Carrera Du Festival, all right, with Joel Robideau. All right. He'll be out there. All right. He's not learning. He says, no, he's not. Joel will not be out there.
No.
At least you could come out there and MC it with me. Get up early on a Saturday. Maybe
I can do that.
All right.
I can do that.
Well,
I can MC.
There. Well, there's, you know, we got the Sabra and the Get Rights, and then in typical Lafayette fashion, there will be food and beverage following the race.
I can do food and beverage.
Drinking beer after 5K is always a lot of fun. First thing on a Saturday morning.
Uh-huh.
All right. Councilwoman Liz Hebert out of District 8, thank you very much.
Thank
Keep
you.
Us updated on the project. Thanks for coming by Sport of Politics.
I'm happy to be here anytime you want me. Thanks again.
Outstanding. All right. We roll on. Stay tuned for more Sport of Politics powered by Charlie G's Louisiana Dunn, the Lafayette Way on a Kid and a Sports Station 103.7 The Game.
Back to Sport of Politics on 103.7 The Game and 1037thegame.com.
All right, Dave Schultz, along with Mayor President Joel Robideau, we did find the parade route out for the Mackenzie Borg / David Schultz parade. Is that what we're calling it now? No?
No.
Just Mackenzie Borg?
Just Mackenzie Borg.
All right.
Yeah.
Well, people would actually show up.
Yes. Well, it's not really a parade if it's just you driving your car down the street with no one on the sides of the
street.
Yeah.
Right. I could drive the car. that he's in.
Oh,
how about
now
that?
Now you're thinking. Well, it's probably risk management would probably mix that and say, yeah, he's a Syracuse driver.
Right. Starting at the fire station, headed up Vermilion, down Jefferson, taking a right on Garfield, stopping at Park International Parade Route. All right, good.
Yep.
There you go. All right, Mackenzie Borg, I think it's
up. Thank you,
Sid. Yeah, 5 p.m. on Saturday.
Yes, okay. That's correct.
All right.
Rain or shine.
Rain or shine.
Yep.
All right. You're lucky I may be covering, you know, you may be getting off the hook with this.
Why?
Because I'm probably covering the women's basketball team trying to defend their WBI title. We're doing the Cajuns game on TV.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
11 a.m. How'd your first pitch go, by the way?
Rain out.
Friday. Last Friday. Yeah,
I've
that was a monsoon.
I've had three rainouts. I think UL has given me the boot.
Right.
Between softball and baseball, I think they're saying, listen, you're bad luck as it relates to the rain.
You're so done.
Farmers are loving me. When I'm scheduled to be the first pitch, then the rain's coming. So we'll hold off.
Okay. All right. So we know when the parade route is. All right. So, and then we had a successful debris drop off.
Yeah, that was, I think we had like 100 and something tons. I mean, some crazy
Jeez.
Number. No, it was very successful. The public responded really, really well to that. And and I think there was over 200 used tires that were dropped off. I mean,
no
it was a
kidding.
Lot. There was a lot dropped off, which is great.
That's fantastic. Know? All right. And how is the no kill zone progress coming along?
Yeah. No kill shelter.
No kill shelter.
Yeah.
Right.
And so, it's good. We've got the report in from Target Zero.
Oh, okay.
I've kind of disseminated it now, internally for everybody to start reviewing it and getting their highlighters out and making notes. And then we're going to get back together, sometime next week to start, you know, trying to put a plan together and sharing ideas and figuring out how to make it happen.
All right. Very good. Very good.
It was a 57-page report, very thorough. So, you know, it's a lot of information to digest, but we've started the process.
Wow. 57 yeah. pages.
57 Jeez. Pages. Yeah. I know All right. You'd have needed a few hour, 5 hour energy drink.
I would
for that.
Yeah, a couple and probably need a week to get through that.
And some big words.
Well, then you go need the dictionary
or
Google, whatever
I'm
we
confident
use.
In your,
whatever we use these
ability.
Days.
Yeah. And regarding Collie Saloon, and I appreciate, Liz coming on.
Right.
You know, the big issue is the, you know, the money. There's no question. I mean, people may have different priorities. Well, you know, with this road versus that road, you know, this drainage project versus, you know, this capital outlay project. But yeah, I don't think anybody's like fully against the College Saloon, widening. And, so we just have to figure out, whether we fund it with a bond issue, which is a whole analysis in and of itself, whether it's the right time to go to the bond markets to try to get a bond issue done. And so we're looking at all of that now because, we want to get it done, but it's not cheap. So we got to figure out, the best financial means to do so. So we're doing that.
Any federal funds available?
Not for Collie Saloon.
Okay.
No.
All right.
Maybe state, but I'm not planning on the state chipping in right,
right.
now. The state situation, they have enough to deal with without us going and, I don't want to.
Well, the transportation.
If we're able to do it, then good.
Well, I was going to say the transportation fund's doing better. Gas has gone up 40 cents.
Yeah, but it's still lower than what it needs to be.
Right.
Now, when I say lower, I don't mean the 40 cents. I mean the amount of money that's going into the transportation trust
Correct.
Fund still.
Correct.
Short of what all the needs are.
Right. Yeah, and this is going to be an issue. Has the governor said anything about a special session yet? And when does he need to do that, if he does so plan to do that? Which I presume is coming, because they're going to cut a bunch of stuff, and they got to...
Yeah. So he's probably, not probably, I mean, I know he's drafting the call to
okay.
say, you know, these are the things that we'll be able to discuss during the special session. But I don't know the dates. I'm not sure of what the process is, but so...
But the ball is rolling, per se.
The ball's rolling, and he'll release the call for the special session while they're in session for
right,
the regular.
Right. Okay. All right. So this
I don't think he'll miss the date, whatever that date is.
Right.
I think he's on top of it.
Okay.
They'll get
Are you telling me there's a date that he needs to announce it, Or he can announce it whenever he wants to.
Right. So it depends when he wants to start. If he wants to start it right on the heels of the regular, then, you know, he knows what that date is. Right. If he wants to give them a week off just to kind of spend a week with their families before they, you know, leave again for 6 weeks.
How long is the regular session?
The regular session goes till June 6th.
So it started last week. So that's March, April, May. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So 3 months.
About 12 weeks. Mm-hmm.
The special session was 3 weeks.
That one was.
You can make the special session as long as you want.
That's correct.
I see. He's probably going to punish them for not doing what he wanted the first time.
Not if he wants to get things passed. You know. punishment doesn't, you know.
Right, that doesn't
necessarily work. That'll be his choices of how does he structure everything to be able to get the votes to pass what he thinks is important to pass.
Then I would ask, can a special session end sooner than expected?
Absolutely. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, all
yeah,
right.
Yeah, you can schedule it for 3 weeks. If they come to some agreement in 10 days, and they can get it all passed, and somebody go make the motion to sign it die.
All right. Well, mm-hmm. We'll finish the way you wanted to start. How's your brackets looking? Did you do a bracket?
I didn't. Well, no, I didn't do a bracket.
No, you didn't do a bracket.
No.
Okay.
Mm-mm. But I don't know who's playing. Who's playing tonight?
Kansas and Maryland playing. And A&M and Oklahoma are playing. Miami and Villanova are playing.
Yeah, I think Kansas is going to have more trouble than people think.
A lot of people think that. Yeah.
I mean, Maryland's got the point guard, you know.
Right.
My old coach, Jack Dale DeLome, said point guard is where it all starts.
Right.
You know, that's the key in tournament play.
Right.
That's what you got to have.
Exactly.
So Maryland definitely has that.
Any hope for my Orange tomorrow against Gonzaga?
Well, you know, that part of the bracket, everybody's just kind of not even paying attention
right.
to because that's the, you know, the lower seeds that kind of messed up everybody
right,
in the bracket
right,
over there.
Right.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, they absolutely have them. I didn't even pick them.
I picked them to win one game.
Yeah, most folks, I think, were complaining they even got in the tournament. They
right.
So, I think they're telling us to wrap up.
Yes, they are. All right, I want to thank Mayor President Joel Robidoux, Liz Hebert, and Dr. Shania Nelson. Thank you for tuning in to Sport of Politics. The Alan Michaels Show is next, and we'll be back on Friday with Sports Chat on Acadiana Sports Station 103.7 The Game.